سيداتي سادتي، ندوتنا الأخيرة لها طابع إنساني. لسيدات عشنا تجارب صعبة كونهن أمهات لجهاديين سابقين. يدير الجلسة هرس رفيق، CEO at Quilliam Foundation، والذي عمل مع رئيس الوزراء البريطاني الأسبق ديفيد كاميرون على خطط للتصدي للإرهاب. ويحاور حرس كل من نيكولا بن يحيى، مؤسسة جمعية Families for Life بالمملكة المتحدة، فيرونيك غوا بوغان، ناشطة في مكافحة التطرف في فرنسا، كارولينا دام، مؤسسة جمعية Sons and Daughters of the World في الدنمارك، وإيديت شلافر، مؤسسة ومديرة Women Without Borders في النمسا.
Thank you very much. And whilst everybody's joining us on the stage, I want to thank May for inviting me to come and moderate this session, and also for your courage and bravery and your determination to build something, a day like you have today, and also moving forward, I'm sure there'll be plenty of good things that come out of it. I was sitting here all day sort of thinking about and sort of hearing all of the very inspirational and motivational women that had spoken before me today, and this is the last session. And I was thinking, well, who's motivated me? Which women have motivated me? And I thought about my mother, and I thought about teachers, and I thought about a whole range of people. And then there's one person in particular that I thought that I would share the story with you before we get into this session. My background is that I was born in the UK. My father went to the UK in 1953 as a social economic migrant. He went to the United Kingdom with £1 in his pocket, and he had a plan. The plan was to save £100, then go back to India and Pakistan. He never went back. He died a millionaire. And I was born, and I sort of grew up a normal life, went into the commercial sector, and was on the board of a number of multinational blue-chip organizations. And then about 12 years ago, my life changed. And I came home one day, and my youngest child, my daughter, she was 7 years of age at the time. And she came home one day and said, "Daddy, I don't want to be a Muslim." I said, "Why don't you want to be a Muslim? What have we done to you? Why don't you want to be a Muslim? Tell me." And she said, "Because Muslims are always angry and they're always killing people. I don't want to be angry, and I don't want to kill anybody. I'm only 7 years old." So I said, "Show me, where are you getting these messages from?" And she showed me on television, and there were some guys, in those days it was Al-Qaeda and the Taliban, and they looked very angry, and they looked like they wanted to kill somebody. And I realized that here was a young girl who didn't know anything about geopolitics, anything about Islam, the faith. She saw mummy and daddy being pious when they were in trouble, searching for God, practicing the salah when they felt particularly pious, fasting during Ramadan. And she knew that she was associating our faith with having to be angry and violent. And this changed my life, it really did. This was the inspiration that I had from a woman, a young girl, a female, who's now a young woman, she's 19 years of age now. And I stopped what I was doing and got involved in this particular area of work. And now I'm CEO of Quilliam, which is the world's first counter-extremism organization. We're not just a think tank, we run lots of projects as well. We've got a very inspirational panel today, and people who are doing things on the ground. It's a European affair. I'm from the United Kingdom, and we have other people from from Europe as well. And I'm sure you can read in the booklet what it is that they're doing, but I want to talk to them about some of the work that they're doing, why they're actually doing what they're doing, and then at the end, this is the last session, I want to get to a place really where we can maybe have some real recommendations and some policy advice and guidance and some practical advice for all of you as well. So I'm just going to join the panelists now. Is it working? Great. The first person on the panel is, we've got Nicola. Nicola, I want you to really share with the audience, with us as well, even though I know your story. Really, you know, you and a couple of other of the women on the panel have lost their children to terrorist organizations to organizations as Daesh, Al-Qaeda, Boko Haram, Al-Shabaab, etc. As a mother, it would have been very, very easy to give up. It would have been very easy to, especially as a Muslim mother, to sit back and say, you know what, enough is enough, I don't want to do any more. Why have you got involved in what you're doing and what drives you?
Like you said, the easiest thing I could have done was just be quiet, remain quiet, because I'd kept it secret for at least a year. My son's been dead now a year, and half my family didn't know. My friends certainly didn't know about it because of the shame that goes with it. That was, like I said, the easiest thing for me to do was to remain quiet. But something had to change. I knew there was something in me, especially after my son died. I still battled getting the right support for my daughters through counseling, through education, and it just wasn't happening. People were perceiving us, rather than a grieving family and helping me to support my other children, they were just looking at us as an extremist family. And so I felt that I had to change, to speak out. It takes that first person to speak out, and you know, then everyone else follows. And that's what I felt I had to do, just to empower people, because it's just such a taboo subject, and we're not talking about it, and our kids are not talking about it. They're talking amongst themselves, where a lot of the radicalization will go on amongst peers, and so they're going to get their answers somewhere else if we don't talk to them.
The next panelist we have is Veronique. Veronique, you've lost a child as well, and Quentin, he converted to Islam. Tell us a little bit about somebody who's not a Muslim. When your son first converted to Islam, what were your thoughts? What were you feeling? And sort of what was your journey sort of going through until you found out that he'd died?
C'est bon? It's good? Ok. Je suis émue d'être là et d'échanger avec vous aujourd'hui. Merci de nous accueillir. Oui, dans mon cas, effectivement, mon fils Quentin, âgé de... It's good? Mon fils Quentin donc, s'est converti à l'islam. Il nous l'a annoncé en 2012. Nous avons accueilli sa nouvelle foi. Il était majeur et on n'avait pas de raison particulière de lui refuser cette religion qui le rendait heureux. On lui a dit, si tu es heureux, on sera heureux avec toi. On n'a jamais pensé que cette conversion pouvait l'amener à se radicaliser et à partir un jour en Syrie. Ça s'est fait très progressivement sur 2 ans. Et lorsqu'il nous a quittés fin septembre 2014, c'est sans nous dire bien sûr où il allait. Il est allé à Francfort. De Francfort, il n'est jamais revenu. Et nous avons appris un mois après qu'il était en Syrie par un appel téléphonique qu'il nous a fait, dans lequel il y avait des sanglots d'ailleurs, puisqu'il nous disait qu'il allait aider des gens, qu'aider des gens, c'était important pour lui, qu'il partait chercher la vérité et qu'il espérait qu'un jour, on comprendrait ce chemin de vérité qu'il était allé chercher, qu'il nous aimait et qu'il nous recontacterait dès qu'il pourrait, mais qu'il ne pouvait pas le faire en ce moment. Et le temps a passé, nous n'avons jamais rompu le contact avec lui. Il continuait de nous aimer et nous l'aimions. Il n'a jamais refusé les valeurs de tolérance et d'humanisme qu'on lui a transmis. On ne comprend pas avec mon mari, mon fils aîné, la famille, comment il a pu basculer là-dedans, si ce n'est à cause des recruteurs qui ont changé son approche de la religion. Ça partait d'un bon sentiment, mais il y a quelque chose qui s'est passé qui l'a conduit à privilégier quelque chose qui ressemble davantage à la haine qu'à l'amour. Et on m'a annoncé sa mort sur WhatsApp en janvier 2016, un inconnu qui m'a envoyé ces mots cruels, « Salam alaikum, l'État bâti sur le sang des martyrs ». Et ce message était accompagné d'un testament où Quentin disait sans date « Si je meurs, remettez mes biens à mes frères, ses frères de religion, qui étaient venus plus importants que ses propres frères. » Et le seul bien qu'il avait, c'était une tablette Samsung. Et dans la deuxième page, il s'adressait à nous Et il nous disait que mes parents sachent que j'ai l'intention de mourir, qu'on ne peut pas vivre dans un monde de faux et d'illusions. Ça ne sert à rien. Ne soyez pas triste, on se retrouvera au paradis. Et il y avait donc nos numéros de téléphone, puisque les messagers sont chargés de prévenir les parents. Mais nous n'avons aucune date, aucun lieu. Nous ne savons pas comment Quentin est mort. Nous n'avons pas de certificat de décès. Nous n'avons pas de sépulture, comme toutes les mamans ici. Donc c'est très difficile de faire un process de deuil. Et pour autant, je ne suis pas dans la haine. J'ai pardonné à mon fils. Je n'en veux pas à la religion. J'en veux à l'islam radical et aux recruteurs qui tuent nos enfants. Parce que c'est de la chair à canon. Et c'est aussi pour ça qu'on se bat aujourd'hui, pour que si on n'arrive pas à les faire rentrer, au moins qu'on évite que certains ne partent. Il ne faut pas qu'ils partent. Et donc la prévention, elle est très en amont et elle se fait au niveau de l'idéologie.
Carolina, your son also converted to Islam. And obviously, there was a period of time when you didn't hear from him and went through all the emotions as well. But one of the things that you often talk about is how your son suffered from a mental illness. Can you elaborate on that a little bit and how important you think that is for recruiters when they're actually targeting youngsters?
Yes. First off, thank you very much, May, for having us again. my son was autistic. He had Asperger's syndrome and he had a ADD. It's pretty unique that, in fact, in a research done by Quilliam within the North, 40% of the kids that have gone to Syria and Iraq have actually autism or Asperger's syndrome, and 50% in The Hague. I think this is a huge target. Our kids are vulnerable in the fact that they're kids, but we must acknowledge the fact as well that they are determined kids. Not every youth stays in bed and sleeps all day. If they are motivated, if they have found their drive, they can become very unique young people. Unfortunately, for my son that had Asperger's, he was vulnerable and he was an easy target. My son, I will say this not only because I'm his mother, but I didn't raise a terrorist. I raised my son with love, very much love. I'm a mother with a huge M. I love my son. I support my son through anything he's been through. But this, I wasn't a part of. He lived a double life that I wasn't aware of. He was extreme Muslim, but he was extreme Muslim because he was autistic. No one in the family or key people around us, caseworkers or whatever, no one said radicalized. I only found out that my son was radicalized by looking at a Facebook ISIS supporters group that claimed that my son wasn't in Turkey, where he said he was. He was in Syria, he was with Daesh, and he was in fact shaheed. He was martyred. Then I found out that my son was living a double life that I had known nothing about. I think it's very important that we see both sides of these kids, because yes, my son might have been vulnerable, but he had a huge heart. He wanted to change the world. Some of these boys and girls, they see destruction everywhere. They see killing, mutilations, they see rape. For some of these kids, they want to be a part of building the caliphate. They want to be a part of building something new to help other people. And this is, in fact, quite beautiful. Don't get me wrong, I condemn Daesh. I don't want to have anything to do with Daesh. But if we just back up a bit and see the boys behind the monster, so to speak, they're trying to do something good. I wish I could talk with my son about these things. I wish I knew what I knew, what I know now back then. Then I would know that I could, as a mother, I might not be Muslim, but I'm a mother. Paradise lies at the feet of your mother. I could use the Quran against my son in the most respectful way, with love. I could challenge him. And this is something that we need to do, not only parents to convert kids, but Muslim parents as well. And we need to do this with the authorities as well. We need to challenge our kids.
Great, thank you. I just want to move on to Dr. Edith Schaefer, who is the head of the Women Against Borders program. And Edith has been doing this work for a long time, certainly I think from since 2002. We have three women here, some very courageous women, you know, whose children had joined terrorist organizations, Daesh in most cases, committed atrocities and then died. They regarded themselves as shaheed, as martyrs, obviously the rest of the world, and we don't. But Edith, you were doing this work well before, long before Daesh and these sort of recent phenomena that we see. Tell us a little bit about what you do as an organization, and also, why do you do this?
I think we can all see that women in the...
Can you move the microphone just a bit closer to yourself, please, Edith?
Yes, okay. Is this okay? Can you hear me? Yes. So women in the security arena dealing with violent extremism come in many roles. Here we hear of women who are our security allies, and they can be sympathizers, they can co-lead, they can be participants, but here we have allies. And this is the reason why I do the work and why I started the work with Women Without Borders. A long time ago, our society was already very divided. That is long before the latest political events. I mean, the division was always there. The otherizing was always there. And for me, the personal was always very political. So I do this from a very personal space because I want to see this world in a better shape. And I do think that women are at the front lines, and we are the missing building block, building up a more secure and inclusive society. So this has always been driving me. I was traveling around the world. I've been working, shadowing women under the Taliban regime, when they, with incredible courage, kept civil society going as nurses, as teachers, in their function as mothers, persuading the kids to stay back. And I talked to women who were at the other side, you know, mothers of suicide bombers who sometimes agreed with the actions of their children, but they, I found, were a minority. More and more I saw this big secret. Secret was also in the room here. The secret that they said, I can't speak publicly, that I hate this idea that he went up into the skies to be a shaheed. I don't feel like a mother of a shaheed. I don't want to be a mother of a shaheed. So I started listening. So if these women feel so isolated, so disconnected, we have to create a community of mothers. And I deeply believe that motherhood is powerful. This is a bond, an emotional bond that binds us together, across cultures, nations, this is something religions we truly have together. And another personal motivation, I'm sick of this old man, whether they came in striped suits or whether they come in religious outfits, kind of telling us what the place of women is, that they are in charge of security and safeguarding our communities, and that they give out the rules. So I thought they don't know anything about what is happening in the family. So we have to go closer, in the closest proximity, and the mothers are in the closest proximity. They have the emotional access, and they have the emotional, and they have the physical access. And we can use this as a security strategy. And we have interviewed mothers. We have done a survey of over 1,000 mothers. It was the first ever survey done, looking into the potential of mothers in their own thinking. The question was, can mothers challenge violent extremism? And we talked to mothers who were concerned, not affected, and they all said, we see ourselves as security allies, but we don't know how. So this is a big question. I think we're all good intentioned, but sometimes we just don't know how to change the world and where to start. So we do have to start from bottom up. This is a bottom-up security strategy in the hands of family members, and from there we have a rippling effect.
Thank you. I just want to come back to Nicola. You know, you've started an organization now called Families for Life, and there'll be many people who haven't had their children joining extremist and terrorist organizations who will say to you, didn't you see the signs? You know, what happened? How did you miss it? How did you not see what was going on? Can you sort of recall back as to what were the signs, and knowing what you know now, what would you have done differently?
Oh no, okay. That's the question that everybody asks me. Did you not? Is that okay? Okay. That's the question everybody asks me. They keep asking me, did you not see the signs? I was very fortunate that I had a very close relationship with not just my son, but with all my children. I was very, very open with them growing up and sort of communicating with them. So if anybody could have seen those signs or known that, it would have been me. And yet, in that time, it was probably over, I would say, year and a half. In hindsight, when you look back, you can pick up pointers. But when they're over a year and a half, it's incredibly difficult to track that. And I always say to people, it's like that's your child. And it's like when you say to somebody, say you've got a husband and wife, and say the husband's having an affair, the last person that will know is the wife. But the woman, everybody else, all his friends will know, but the last person will, because emotionally you're too near. And I always said, you need somebody from outside, as somebody who's not emotionally attached, to give you that outside perspective and to be able to join those dots. But it's a huge amount as a mother or a parent to put on without outside help. You can't do it alone.
So how are you doing this now with your new organization? How are you getting involved with counter-radicalization now?
Because the one thing that could have saved my son is if I'd known that, like, for example, because the investigation was going on, I contacted Daniel Kohler, the researcher in Germany, and he was absolutely crucial in helping me throughout the process. And if I had him, when I just had that intuition, because you have it, initially, you just have an intuition as a mother. There's just something not quite right, but you can't name it. But if I'd had him, that would have helped. And what I'm trying to do, what I've done, is set up Families for Life. And it's really to help people, even if they have a niggle, because I've had some parents come up to me, and when they know about my story, they start sharing with me about their child, not necessarily about radicalization, but they'll be saying that they've got anxiety or depression. But when you dig further, you realize actually there could be a possibility they're going down that road, but the parents haven't quite connected the dots. And that's what Families for Life is kind of there for, is for people at very, very early signs, just to be able to kind of guide them through that, but also as a process, because you do feel very isolated, and there's a lot of parents and siblings out there suffering in silence with no support. And this is why I set up Families for Life, for it to be able to, because I'm a qualified counsellor, is to give them that kind of space to talk about it and grieve.
Great, thank you. Veronica, I'd like to ask you a question around, you haven't set up an organisation, you now call yourself a counter-extremism practitioner or an activist. What is it you're doing? What is it that you're doing in real terms, and what challenges are you facing, either within your home country or challenges that you're facing within other communities abroad, be they Muslim or non-Muslim? Yes, basically what I was saying was that you haven't set up an organization, you're a practitioner, a counter-extremism practitioner. You go out there and you speak about these things and speak about these issues. What actually are you doing practically? What challenges are you having and facing either in your home country or around the rest of the world, and how are you overcoming them?
Oui, absolument. J'ai une valeur de témoignage en tant que parent. Je précise d'ailleurs au passage que je ne le fais pas seul, je le fais aux côtés de mon mari qui n'est pas là aujourd'hui, mais il y a aussi des hommes qui sont très investis dans ce travail, parce qu'effectivement, voilà, nous ne sommes pas seuls. C'est assez facile pour nous aujourd'hui, enfin quand je dis facile, c'est compliqué, mais c'est facile d'en parler parce qu'on a appuyé sur le bouton replay et qu'on peut revenir en arrière sur notre histoire. Mais il faut savoir que quand on est dedans, on ne comprend pas les signes. Qui plus est, moi, quand ça m'est arrivé entre donc 2012 et 2014, ce n'était pas la situation d'aujourd'hui. On ne parlait pas autant de l'État islamique. Et donc, il y avait beaucoup de signes en fait, qui nous alertaient, qui n'annonçaient pas le départ en Syrie, une éventuelle participation à un groupe terroriste. Mais par contre, il y avait une pratique fondamentaliste qui devenait très inquiétante parce qu'elle excluait notre enfant de la vie normale. C'est-à-dire que ceux qu'il fréquentait et qui l'ont conduit à se radicaliser, en fait, n'acceptaient aucune tolérance. Il fallait être comme eux et pas différent. Et pour des raisons que je ne m'explique pas encore aujourd'hui, je ne comprends pas comment Quentin, qui était un enfant normal, sans difficulté en tout cas apparente, un enfant qui faisait des études, qui était structuré au niveau familial, on n'est pas parfait, mais personne n'est parfait, qui avait une vie amoureuse, qui était certes hypersensible, donc très tourné vers l'autre et l'altruisme, à tel point qu'il avait fait une quête pour Haïti dans les Caraïbes. C'est un pays très touché par la misère et notamment un tremblement de terre dans les années 2010. Son papa est né en Haïti et il avait collecté à l'époque 4500 euros pour aider ce pays. Et bizarrement, lorsqu'il est devenu musulman, il a entendu que les musulmans souffraient plus que les autres. Et ses frères musulmans radicaux l'ont amené finalement à partir, parce que être musulman un moment en France, dans un pays de mécréance, ce n'était plus compatible. C'est-à-dire qu'il avait le choix entre se soumettre à Dieu, puisque le djihad, selon eux, est une obligation. Donc il fallait qu'il se soumette à Dieu et, en oubliant en fait le respect au père et à la mère. Tout en continuant à nous aimer, il nous disait « Je sais que vous souffrez, je souffre aussi, vous me manquez, mais je dois obéir à Dieu. C'est un sacrifice que Dieu nous demande. » C'est terrible l'état de soumission dans lequel ils les mettent, tout en utilisant en fait des codes d'honneur, parce qu'en fait les codes djihadistes sont pleins de références un peu guerrières sur l'obéissance, la fierté, etc. Et en fait la cruauté, elle vient par-dessus, mais elle ne vient pas tout de suite. Et il y a un moment où ils ne peuvent pas faire machine arrière. C'est-à-dire qu'en fait, il ne faut pas que les jeunes partent. Et ils continuent de partir. C'est ça qui est horrible. Malgré la prévention, malgré l'information, des jeunes continuent de partir. Et là, j'ai rencontré deux mamans avant d'arriver. L'une dont le fils est ingénieur en informatique. Il est encore en France, mais il est radicalisé. Il a fait un Erasmus à Londres. Il est parti 3 mois. Il est rentré radicalisé. Et une autre famille, un jeune d'à peine 18 ans qui est parti et la maman est sans nouvelles depuis, enfin les parents sont sans nouvelles depuis 2 mois et demi. Donc bizarrement, ça continue parce que c'est un état de guerre et les jeunes qui partent là-bas vous disent, il suffit de lire les conversations sur Twitter que rapportent certains journalistes spécialisés, en fait, nous n'attaquons pas, nous sommes attaqués. Voilà, ils prétendent que cette guerre, ce n'est pas eux qui la font. Mais nous la faisons, quand je dis nous, collectivement. Hein. Et donc, c'est une riposte. Et cette riposte est dictée par Dieu. Donc, on est dans un... C'est à la fois, si vous voulez, idéologique, religieux. Il y a quand même du religieux là-dedans, et c'est surtout politique. Donc, c'est très compliqué.
Thank you. Carolina, can I ask you this question? But I want you just to touch on something. Because I know some of your story, I know some of the difficulties you've had. What challenges have you faced? What hurdles have you had? And how have you overcome them? These are societal hurdles or governmental hurdles. What are the problems that you've had when you've tried to do something about preventing what happened to your son to other children?
Well, when my son was 15, he actually went underground for several months. And I called the police every day. I called the municipality every day for help, trying to find my son. Because as a mother, how can I justify that my son went underground? That's one thing. But I knew he lived with 3 adult extreme Muslim men. How can I justify that my 15-year-old is living with 3 adult men that I have never seen before? I can't. I called the police every single day. Their response was, because Lucas called me on a payphone every day, their response was, As he is calling you every day, we can't place a missing child case because he is in fact in contact with you. When that said, if I call the police today and said in one sentence, my 15-year-old has gone underground living with three adult extreme Muslim men, they would have changed something. So we are learning from our mistakes. But when my son left, the authorities knew something was going on. One of the worst recruiters in Denmark, the one that recruited my son, he has been under surveillance for several years with the secret police. They knew about my son, but they didn't reach out to me as a mother. How can we connect these parents with the knowledge from the Secret Service if they're not willing to share the information? We have to make sure that they have the knowledge, that they're equipped to know that something's going on. During the 7 months where Lucas, he had left, he ran off to Syria. I didn't know he left. During the 7 months, I didn't know who to talk with. After 4 months, I was contacted by the Danish Copenhagen de-radicalization unit. And they just told me that if he has been gone for 4 months or thereafter, he's probably not coming back. That's it. So for what I'm trying to do now with Sons and Daughters of the World, I work only around 20% on prevention work because I use around 80% of my work, apart from my day job, on damage control. That's when these kids have gone to Iraq or Syria. We are desperately in need of funds, so if you want to donate anything, please go on my webpage. When we receive any notion from families that their sons or daughters have left for the country, we set up at the borders. I contact my contacts at the border, try to stop them at the border. We set up bounties. Everything's money down there, and you can go a long way with money. So if we can get in contact with anyone that has any information on safe houses or with these kids, we provide a bounty. We help these parents as well when their kids have gone to talk with their kids, because when the kids die, the majority of these kids are not coming home. So a lot of parents are sitting around waiting for their kids to die. Just imagine trying to go to work, knowing that your son or daughter is in Syria and waiting for them to die. This is something that we need to address. We need to reach out. We need to make sure that the parents know that they have to talk to their kids because they might not get another chance. We have to erase every issue that is regarding our kids. We have to say the word jihad. Jihad doesn't only mean holy war. Jihad is beautiful. It means some of the most beautiful things in our world: to create a better yourself, to get an education, to provide for others that don't have money or funds or anything, to help and to take care of your parents. This is actually empathy. This is love, people. This is love. And we need to talk about these things because it's not about the religion. I love Islam. I'm not Muslim, but Islam gave my son something that I couldn't give him. And it gave him a sense of belonging, a sense of something higher, something more powerful. And I'm not talking about Daesh or ISIS or Nusra or anything else. I'm talking about Islam. I'm talking about what it gave my son. For a mother that has a son that has deficiencies with Asperger's, it's nothing less than fantastic to see that your child is striving, that your child is finally at peace with himself because of religion. And that's beautiful.
Thank you. Thank you. Edith, you're... Yes.
Thank you very much.
Edith, I think your organization now is working, I think, in 9 countries at the moment, and obviously moving on into other countries as well. I don't know whether you have some videos that you might want to show us. Do you want to just talk us through, I think there's two or three very short 1 minute videos, if you want to just very briefly mention what they are, and then maybe we can play them?
To share with you a few videos which I think can show much better than any explanation what we are doing. We have built up a movement of mother schools. These are new challenges. I mean, this was very impressive to hear now that alone you can't deal with violent extremism. If you're alone, you need a community, you need a movement, you need understanding, you need support. And facing authorities on your own is also very complicated and obviously not very successful. So bringing women together, like-minded women, who maybe not are not even affected, we very much work in the preventative arena, women who are concerned before it is too late, before they sit in your chairs, to share, to talk with each other, to speak honestly, and to discuss how to update and upgrade their mothering and parenting skills. Because what we're dealing with is not in any parenting book. We don't find it. We need advice, we need support, we need each other, and we need to approach the policy shapers that they implement this as national, local, international policy strategies. I think this is about an inclusive security approach. We work now in many countries, in Kashmir, for example, in Indonesia, but also across Europe. And I have brought some examples from Indonesia and Kashmir for two reasons. I feel very hopeful when I look at Indonesia. Also, we have seen some disturbing records, but in Indonesia, the largest Muslim population worldwide, there is hope, there is inclusivity, there is moderation. So we work with these women there, and I will show a short clip where you can see what is going on within the mother schools. Mothers learn about developmental stages of their children. I mean, the profile of a terrorist or a violent extremism, there's not one profile. We could see this. They were quite normal kids. There's not one profile, but they have something in common. They are vulnerable, and the recruiters, they target the vulnerability. So I think this is important to know how to relate with your children, how to interact, how to listen, not to take shortcuts. You know, this is rubbish. This is the usual thing we say when a kid comes with something outrageous. Stop it. As long as you live under my roof, you never ever want to hear this again. No, we want to instill the curiosity in the women and you know, kind of upgrading their skills to listen, to empathize. All of these are the typical recruiter's tools. They are perfect. And they extract the kids from where they actually belong to without having the emotional access that the mothers have. So I think the mothers have to reclaim this space and we have to work in this together. And I will show you briefly the first clip. It is a small group, you will see, because not all the mothers felt comfortable to being filmed. It's a clip out of a television documentary.
Learning to cope with such bloody events in their neighborhood is one part of the training. Mothers also must learn alternative strategies and leadership qualities.
This time the situation in Kashmir is not good. Somewhere roads are being blocked, stone pelting is taking place, bombs are blasting, tear gas shells are being thrown. We can fight back at it all. We can fight it by sitting at home, by starting peace in our homes at an individual level. A woman can only lead and become a leader if she is able to express herself well. And if she is able to become a leader, she can lead other mothers in a mother school. She can do anything if she is strong. She can even run the world.
The sound issue for the second one? Yes? Sure? Okay, so let's play the second one now as well. The second one is in Indonesia, Edith?
The mother's school places tools in the hands of mothers, tools which allow them to deploy emotional resources and work against radicalization. In this exercise, the mothers learn the different stages of psychological development, from baby to adulthood, and become aware of the unconscious processes their children are going through.
Hanya takut kepada Allah, tidak takut kepada manusia. Mulailah.
Our son Adian started to radicalize when he was 14 years old.
Si anak ini tadi mulai ada
He stopped respecting humans and only had respect for God.
Usianya yang masih 14 tahun saat itu.
At this time, he wanted to leave school because he thought that only religious knowledge would make any sense in life.
Maunya SMP berhenti sudah. Karena mubah, sia-sia, tidak ada gunanya selain ilmu agama.
Through the work of the mother's school, Hedaya was able to rebuild her communication with her son. In the meantime, Adian finished his schooling. Hedaya now wants to use her experience as a trainer in the new mother's school. The day of the festive march by the mother's schools. The entire village population of 500 is out and about. Many have traveled from afar to admire the skillful youth of Lady Combo, and most important, to see the proud mother school's graduates.
...1,400 women marched together, and the villagers came and they cheered, the policemen came to support them, the fathers, the men of the community where the other children danced, they came with poems. This was, I think, a really life-changing moment in their lives, and this was the beginning of a whole movement of the creation of further generations of mother schools.
Time is running out. I'll give you an opportunity just to talk about that. What I want to do now is just do a very quick, unfortunately time has run out, it's caught up with us. I just want each of the panelists to take 1 minute only, please, and I will be very, very tight on this, just to some real recommendations that you can make to the audience and perhaps to anybody out there who might be listening from a policy perspective as well.
I think, for me, I think it's the taboo of all of this, really. It's, we're just not talking about it. So if I could actually recommend just saying to people, encouraging people, parents, sisters, brothers, just talk about it. Because actually, although it's really scary, it's really important to talk about it and really reach out, because it can be the difference between actually life and death. Because if I was able to reach out to the appropriate people very early on, my son would be alive today, I know that, but it was just too late, so yeah.
Veronique, can I ask you the same question? Please, to 1 minute, advice, recommendations that you may have from a practical perspective.
Si j'ai juste un conseil, effectivement une recommandation, si vous voyez dans votre entourage un jeune, un garçon ou une fille en train de changer dans sa pratique religieuse, puisqu'effectivement il y aura eu une conversion avant, à moins que vous ne sachiez pas, parlez-en. Même si ça ne sert à rien, si vous pensez que ce n'est pas utile, faites-le. Parce que, je le répète, dans le cas de mon fils, certains dans son entourage, ça ne se passait pas à la maison le problème. C'était à l'extérieur. Et des jeunes, notamment d'une association de musulmans qu'il fréquentait, l'ont vu se radicaliser avec des signaux assez forts qui ne manifestaient pas à la maison. Et lorsque je les ai rencontrés un an après le départ de Quentin, parce que j'ignorais leur existence, je leur ai dit, mais pourquoi vous n'avez rien fait? Et ils ont dit, c'est pas nous. Et en fait, pour moi, c'est non-assistance à personne en danger. Donc c'est vraiment important d'aider aussi les parents qui ne voient pas les signes, parce que parfois ils sont cachés. Parce que le caché fait partie aussi de la stratégie des recruteurs. C'est ce qu'on appelle la dissimulation. Et donc, en fait, au sein de la famille, ils ne vont pas être explicites pour ne pas inquiéter les parents. Et le jour où ils partent, les parents ne savent jamais. Donc aidez-nous à l'extérieur, c'est très important.
Thank you. Carolina, again, 1 minute from you. Some real practical advice that you can give to people would be really, I think, helpful.
Well, some of it isn't rocket science. Talk to your kids. That's the most important thing. I will just say one quick thing. We do challenge our kids as mothers. Lucas, he came home one day. All of a sudden, he didn't want to be with his cat. He loved his cat. They had a very strong bond. I told him, I thought it was dogs that you're not allowed to interact with. No, it's cats as well. I called a mother, a Muslim mother. She told me a story about Muhammad, the prophet, peace and belongs be with him. I went home, I told Lucas the same thing, but because I used the word prophet, Muhammad, and peace and blessings be upon him, and told him a story, he instantly got out, got the cat again. This is challenge. So don't believe that your son is actually, he might believe it to be true, but someone else told him this. And even though I'm not Muslim, I do use the Quran with my with my other parents as well, because these are the things that we can challenge. And this is important for all the cases. We have to understand why it is important for them that they want to build a caliphate. And if we understand these things behind this child, we can use the same things to change the narratives. I think it's very, very important. Thank you.
Great, thank you. And Edith, I noticed just in your video some parents, if I can just ask you just for a minute, perhaps a minute, minute and a half, did you get a chance to explain the video? And then I will have to wrap up after that.
We see a video again from Kashmir. This is the last session we had, and we had surprise visitors, which I found quite scary, a whole group of men marching towards the place where we're sitting, and now you see what happened.
A mother's school has already taken place over a number of months. That this concept actually works and changes the communication within the family is noticed, especially by the sons.
Earlier, we would discuss things with our mother, and she would hardly pay any heed. She would not try to understand. But since she joined mother's school, I see a change in her. Now I discuss things with her, and she listens. I think if she comes to mother's school again, we can be more open with her. I expect more changes in my mother's behavior. I also read the modules and I was very impressed. I made a copy and I used to read it. It opened my eyes. Earlier, if we saw anything in the market or anything happened outside, we would not share it with our mothers. But now we do, and we take our mothers along. We also took part in some demonstrations, and we took them along. Now they are also very much concerned about our education and everything we do. I think there is an improvement in communication with the mother.
With the knowledge gained from the women, the mother's schools can react to the acute problems of each individual state.
Edith, just again, just very quickly, final recommendations. And I think it was very interesting to see, you know, the sons and husbands actually taking on board some of the work you're doing as well.
We did not access them directly. We did not dare to do that. We thought that would be a longer process. But we already saw the change of dynamics in the families because the mothers report back in the mother schools. We follow the dynamics via Skype from wherever we are, from our headquarters in Vienna. We have now 1,500 participants in mother schools who went through mother schools. So it's a very interesting process. And the fathers and the sons are increasingly approaching the mothers and ask them, what is our role? So that shows us that they are as concerned, they are as alarmed. But masculinity is a shield, you know, they are shielded. They are afraid that they have failed as protectors of the families, as strong men. What was requested or expected, they thought, in their communities, and maybe it's true. So I do think to bring them in as security allies is extremely important. We also managed to bring in police, female police officers, not into the mother schools. That certainly would not go well with the trusted space that is needed, but in the trainings where we train our mother school teachers, we do have now police so that the mothers get information. If they're concerned, they find a friendly, empathetic vis-a-vis who helps them, advises them before it is too late. And they're not alone in that struggle, as some of the mothers have been here when the worst already was happening.
So Edith, can I just stop you there? Sorry, I think some people have to go. So we've run out of time. We've overrun already. I just wanted to say thank you to all of you, and please join me in giving the panelists a round of applause. And thank you for staying and listening to this final session.